Hi there. I'm Steve Taylor. And when I'm not directing movies or touring the world with my band, I'm the filmmaker in residence here at Lipscomb University's new Film and Creative Media Master's program. And you know what? I even take classes here. Why? Because I believe that a true artist is always learning. Always growing. Always solving problems.
That's right, Steve.
Always experimenting. Always honing my craft. At Lipscomb University, we don't graduate filmmakers. We graduate heroes. Hi there. I'm Steve Taylor. We made that video 5 years ago, and I'm still wearing the same suit. Why am I standing behind this lectern? Maybe I'm not wearing pants. I don't get asked to do a lot of public speaking, for reasons you'll soon discover. And when I do, it's usually for college students. So when I was asked to give the keynote to Hutchmoot, I had two thoughts. First, as a fan of everything this conference stands for, I don't want to screw this opportunity up. But my second concern is this: what assumptions can I make? Some of you who know me from music probably have certain expectations, which I'm surely going to disappoint. Some of you know me from the movies I've made, which ended up ruffling even more feathers than the music I've made. Some of you may even know me as the director of Lipscomb University's School of Theater and Cinematic Arts, which is a textbook example of how institutional hierarchies elevate leaders to the level of their incompetence. Some of you enjoy my work as the lead singer of Aerosmith. But Hutchmoot gathers such an interesting mix of authors and musicians and artists and academics and pastor theologians that instead of focusing my talk on just one segment of this very diverse audience, I'm going to assume none of you know anything about me, and I'll try and keep the talk broad enough so I can bore all of you equally. One thing we know that unites all Hutchmooters is a love of the written word. So I'm going to start off by referencing a work of literature that's made a big impact on me. It's called The Idiot's Guide to Public Speaking, and on page 14, it stresses the need for a public speaker to establish his or her credentials early on in order to gain the audience's trust. So for those of you who don't know anything about me, I'm a writer-director of motion pictures, and this is a poster of the first movie I made. It's called A Second Chance. It was distributed in theaters by Sony Pictures Releasing. The subject matter may have been a little ahead of its time, and you probably can't see all the credits, but my name, Steve Taylor, is listed 5 times. And this is the poster from my second movie. It's called Blue Light Jazz. It's based on the New York Times bestselling memoir by Donald Miller. It premiered at the South by Southwest Film Festival, followed by a theatrical release. The subject matter may have been a little ahead of its time. And once again, my name, Steve Taylor, appears 5 times for a credibility enhancing 10 times in 2 movies. Not that any of this makes me an expert on directing movies. Maybe you've never even seen Blue Light Jazz, which kind of hurts my feelings. But I'm also a recording artist. This is the cover from a recent album. And yes, that is my name on the upper left next to the elk. Here's a photo of another band I'm in. We all wear jumpsuits because we can. And there's another band I was in before some of you were born. The name of the band is Chagall Guevara, which may have been our first mistake. We just reunited to release this live album. And again, I don't mean to brag, but that's me in 4 of those shots. But hey, not all of you are fans. I get that. I also write and produce songs for other bands. And I'm curious if any of you would recognize some of these songs. So we're gonna play Name That Tune. If any of you grew up in an evangelical Christian home in the 90s, chances are good you've heard this song. In fact, if you grew up in a Christian home, chances are you were forced to sing that song whether you wanted to or not. That's how it worked at our house when our daughter was young. She'd say, "Daddy, can I please go to bed?" "No, not until you say your prayers and sing Shine." Here's another song I wrote for the same Australian band, Newsboys, that you also may have heard. know why that's one of the most popular Christian songs of all time? Because if you sing along, you get to say hell over and over again. That was my gift to you growing up. You're welcome. And if I still haven't established any credibility with you, if you haven't seen any of my movies or bought any of my albums or heard either of these songs, I've still got one more. This is a song I produced that was a worldwide pop hit at the turn of the millennium.
Kiss me out of the bearded barley.
If you've never heard that song, there's only two possible explanations. You were either homeschooled by Amish parents, or you've never shopped at TJ Maxx. We're going to talk about art today. And if I were listening to this talk, this is where I would turn it off. Because I just don't want to hear another anybody talk about the meaning of art ever again. But hold on, because if you stick with me, this could get interesting, and hopefully relevant. Because I'm recording this in the year 2020, a year so traumatic for most of us that it someday may disappear from our calendars, the way 13 has disappeared from elevator panels. And in 2020, I've been wondering, how useful is art when our world is on fire? We'll get to that in a minute. But first, some of you may be thinking, I'm not even an artist. What do I care? Well, you may not consider yourself an artist, but do you at least consider yourself creative? Every once in a while, I'll be in a conversation with some fellow adults, and we're talking about a piece of art we just saw, or watched, or heard, or maybe one of us has made, and someone will inevitably say, I'd love to do something like that, but I'm just not creative. Now, what exactly does that mean, I'm not creative? And at what age did they decide that? Can you imagine being in a room full of kindergartners, and you give them each a lump of clay and tell them to make something, and one of the kids says, teacher, I want to do the assignment, but I'm just not creative. I have never heard a kid say that, ever, and if they did, I would punish them by making them sing Shine over and over again. Saying I'm not creative is like saying I'm not sentient, because we were born creative. We were made that way by the Creator. The challenge is not whether or not we've got creativity in us. The challenge is, what are we going to do with it? What are we going to use it for? Maybe it's a work of art. Maybe it's a mobile app. Maybe it's an innovative business model. Maybe it's creating a better way to teach. I went to college at the University of Colorado at Boulder, which was and still is a pretty radical campus environment. I studied music and film. Either of those majors on their own was known at the time as the zero job prospect degree. But when music and film are combined together, they actually create something in physics that is known as the future unemployment vortex, out of which eventually emerges a modern barista. And yet, I dared to dream. I was working as a church youth pastor at the time, while I was attending college. And while I love being a youth pastor, when I graduated, I wanted to pursue a career in music and filmmaking as an artist entertainer. Now, this confused many of the people in my church, who, like most church people at the time, thought that pursuing a career in the arts was vastly inferior to a career in ministry. In fact, the British poet Steve Turner once pointed out that according to their way of thinking, God has a hierarchy when it comes to choosing a profession. At the top were evangelists, missionaries, all those in full-time Christian service. The next rung would be doctors, nurses, and all other caregivers. And then came teachers, veterinarians, law enforcement, the guy who invented Dippin' Dots. And down near the bottom were artists and anyone else working in entertainment. Then they made things even worse by sending out the not-so-subtle inference that if I had to be an artist, if I couldn't find a more worthy spiritual profession, I could redeem myself by following the church's sub-hierarchy in the world of artistic expression. At the top of the truly Christian pursuits in the arts were all songs that mentioned Jesus by name, followed by End Times movies and Amish romance novels, followed by the sequel to End Times movies and Amish romance novels, and at the bottom of that list were any forms of artistic expression that allow room for imagination, nuance, and renewing the mind. So let's fast forward a few decades to see the result of this utilitarian way of looking at the arts. I'm going to show you two paintings. The first is one that many people, both inside and outside the church, think of as Christian art. It's by the most successful modern painter of our time. His works are in more American homes than any other painter, living or dead. And here is one of this artist's best-known works. Take a long look and study this painting. Is it technically accomplished? Sure. Was it made to glorify God? It says so on the painter's website. Is it glorifying to God? Most of my fellow Christians would say, absolutely. I disagree. Why? Because I think this painting is a lie. Forget the purple trees. Forget the fact that apparently the only way to attend this church is to parachute in by helicopter, since there isn't even a path to the front door. Thomas Kincaid called himself the painter of light, but even his light is a lie, because the only way to get windows to glow like that is to set the church pews on fire. This is Christian art? How can that be? Thomas Kincaid claimed, "I like to portray a world without the fall, as in the fall of man." But how can a quote-unquote Christian artist create an entire world with no pain, no darkness, a world that avoids even our very need for redemption? Jesus said, "You will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." Is this the truth? Here is another painting. In 1937, the Nazis bombed the Spanish town of Guernica in order to test their new aerial weaponry. This was painted by the Spanish artist Pablo Picasso as a response to the destruction of war on innocent lives. Pablo Picasso is not anyone's idea of a Christian artist. To my knowledge, he never publicly expressed any religious conviction. So was this painted to glorify God? We can say with a fair degree of certainty, no. Is it glorifying to God? Well, let's think about that. The more you study the Kincaid painting, the more ridiculous it looks. The more you study the Picasso painting, the more truth it reveals about the horror of war. One painting tells the truth, the other is a lie. So which one glorifies God? Now I'm going to reference two movies. The first is representative of what many people, both inside and outside the church, think of when they hear the label Christian movie. It's by the most successful Christian filmmaking team of our time. Some of you may have seen this movie in church. And the plot goes something like this. The coach of a Christian high school football team is having a bad year. His team can't win. The parents want him fired. His car won't start. His wife can't conceive. His home is a mess. He's out of money. And he's a big jerk. Then a mysterious stranger shows up at his office, shares a Bible verse, and tells him the Lord sent him there. And abracadabra, everything starts going right. People love him. The team wins state. He gets a raise. One of the parents gives him a brand new pickup truck. And his wife gets pregnant. And at the very end of this movie, just in case you didn't get the message that God magically fixes everything in your life, we fast forward 2 years to learn the team's now won 2 state championships, and the coach's wife is pregnant again. Does this story tell the truth? Well, maybe. If your image of Jesus is this, the story makes even better sense if your image of Jesus is this. But when you put the plot I've just described inside the context of what used to be described as a biblical worldview, it doesn't make any sense at all. The plot I've just described is a specifically American wish fulfillment fantasy that only makes sense if it involves a winning lottery ticket or a visit from Santa. Contrast the plot of that movie with another movie you may or may not have seen. It opens with Robert Duvall playing Mack Sledge, a washed-up country singer who wakes up in a rundown Texas roadside motel after a night of heavy drinking. He asks the owner, a widow with a young son, if he can work in exchange for his room. She tells him yes, as long as he doesn't drink during work hours. He resolves to give up drinking, and after a period of struggle, he starts attending church. He eventually marries the widow, and he gets baptized. And that's the point where, unlike the other movie, everything starts going badly. He tries to reconcile with his 18-year-old daughter from a previous marriage, but his ex-wife won't let him see her. He contemplates leaving his new family to restart his singing career. He stays broke. He finally reconciles with his daughter, and then she's tragically killed in a car wreck. At the end of this movie, There's no new car, no state championship, no million-dollar recording contract. Just Mac, back at the old motel with his new wife and son, wondering aloud why God granted him a new life, and yet his daughter has lost hers. How is it that at the end of this movie, with so many things unresolved, I felt hope? The Bible says in Romans 5:3, we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance, character, and character, hope. That's the truth. But in the Christian movie, where everything went right, where every strand of the story is neatly boxed up in unicorn gift wrap and a rainbow-colored bow, I felt depressed. Jesus says, you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. One of those movies uses creative storytelling to express a truth about the cost of discipleship. The other uses formulaic storytelling to express an American wish fulfillment fantasy. Guess which one made more money? Okay, let's pause for a minute, because I know a lot of you are with me so far, and a few of you are thinking, wow, I really liked that football movie. I cried. I did too, but for different reasons. But some of you are thinking, okay, this sounds good, but what you're talking about is hard to do. Yes, it is. So where do we start? The first definition of the word creative is this: relating to or involving the imagination or original ideas. What stops us from being creative? I don't know what it's like for you growing up, but at both my public school and my church, everyone was suspicious of the weird kids. My friend Phil Vischer, the co-creator of VeggieTales, once pointed this out, how oftentimes these are the kids that don't quite fit in. They're drawn to things that are out of the mainstream, that may be a little eccentric. Imagine a teenage girl who attends your church, but she usually dresses up like she's in a goth metal band. And every once in a while, just to switch it up, she has this thing about covering herself in mud. And one day, she comes to church holding a rancid, moldy, wadded-up t-shirt to show off to everybody like it's a puppy. How comfortable would your church, or even this conference, be with someone like that? If not, we just rejected the prophet Jeremiah, the world's first performance artist. These are the kids that often become artists. If a church shows no enthusiasm for their artistic passions, chances are their faith will play no future role in helping shape and inform their career. Another barrier that holds us back is simply this: we're afraid. 2 Timothy 1:7 reminds us that God has not given us the spirit of fear, and yet it's an unspoken, often unconscious fear that keeps us out of culture-shaping careers in the arts and entertainment. Christianity has seen successful models of what it's like to be a committed Christian and, say, a football star, thanks to Christian ministries who've partnered with athletes for decades. But we have a harder time imagining a committed Christian who's a Broadway producer, or a Netflix executive, or a female rap artist. A lot of these fears are based on legitimate concerns. Imagine yourself in a vocation where you're constantly being asked to compromise your beliefs, where it's dog-eat-dog 24/7, where sexual temptation is everywhere and the use of illicit drugs is rampant. I'm talking, of course, about the world of investment banking. Because the business world isn't any more ethical or moral than Hollywood. It's just got a suit and tie on. And finally, there's a very dangerous misperception that's been part of American church culture since before I can remember. We grew up being taught that if we're doing it for the Lord, it doesn't really matter how well we do it. Now, I don't know exactly where we got that. Maybe it's because we're nice people who don't like to criticize. But the fact is that poorly crafted, derivative art and entertainment made by Christians is still bad. I'll sometimes hear a defense from a fellow Christian saying something like this: yeah, I know that last Kirk Cameron movie wasn't very good, but God has really used it to bring people to Christ. Now, maybe that's true, but does that justify bad art? Think about it. Couldn't the same results happen without the bad art? And while we're at it, when did we as Christians decide that the ends justify the means? It would be like saying, yeah, I know the Spanish Inquisition wasn't very good, but God has really used it to bring people to Christ. And comparing the Spanish Inquisition to most of the Christian movies I've seen is harsh but fair. Both happened in dark rooms and involved hours of torture. I'm not trying to be flippant, but we live in a media-saturated world. So if you don't have talent and a passion for excellence, maybe you shouldn't bother. The reason most art and entertainment produced by Christians never finds a world audience is because it's simply not good enough. Which is why we've got to do better than reach for the lowest hanging fruit or wait for the next fad to rip off. And I know this is a charge that frequently gets leveled at Christian media, and it's not entirely fair to single it out, because the fact is that mainstream media companies are doing the same thing, pumping out sequels and remakes and ripping off each other's reality shows and book franchises. But I would argue that the mainstream still recognizes the value of original voices, which is how a company like Pixar can make a blockbuster about a rat chef. Do we value originality? When it comes to music, would an original voice even consider signing with one of the big Christian music labels? Not many that I'm aware of. A true artist wants to be where originality and creativity is celebrated, not stifled. And this is an odd state of affairs because some of our most original artists have been our most successful. Writers like Tolkien and Lewis, Flannery O'Connor, Marilyn Robinson, filmmakers from Wim Wenders to Terrence Malick, musical artists from Coltrane to U2, Rich Mullins to Sufjan. Even a kid series like VeggieTales had no ready parallel when it first appeared. It was so fresh and original that college students at the time were memorizing their silly songs. I remember when I first finished most of the songs that became my first album, I Want to Be a Clone. I took a trip to LA and managed to get meetings with a number of A&R people at mainstream record labels. The music was a punk new wave hybrid that was getting a good reaction, but their response, for the most part, was, "We like your music, but your lyrics would offend our listeners." So I thought, well, if it's the Christian content that's the problem, I'll try meeting with Christian record labels. And their response was, "We don't like your music, and your lyrics would offend our listeners," which has pretty well defined the rest of my career. 25 years later, the biggest challenge in getting my last movie, Blue Like Jazz, off the ground was that it didn't have a ready parallel. In other words, we weren't remaking an idea that had already proved successful. And then there was the matter of a movie with Christian themes that wasn't safe for the whole family. Now, I'm all in favor of family entertainment. But the story of Blue Like Jazz takes place on a real campus, Reed College in Portland, Oregon, which the Princeton Review labeled the most godless campus in America. How do you set a story there without portraying the reality of what it's like? It doesn't have to be R-rated, but if it's not PG-13, it's going to seem a little ridiculous, right? Are we not allowed to tell those stories? If you're an entity that funds Christian media, or you own one of the few Christian bookstores that are left, the answer is no, you're not allowed to tell those stories. Why? Because they're not safe for the whole family. Evidently, these stores aren't familiar with the Bibles they're selling, because a family-friendly version of the Bible would be a much shorter book, wouldn't it? Now, some of you watching who've experienced dealing with the Christian media industrial complex are thinking, okay, Steve, this sounds good, but let's be honest. There are times when Christians are called to tell truths that people flat out don't want to hear. That is inarguable. So how do we get their attention? This is where creativity has to be paired with courage. I repeat, when you're trying to speak truth to people who don't want to hear it, pair creativity with courage. The Bible is full of examples, from Old Testament prophets trying to find creative ways to tell people bad news without getting killed for it, to Jesus, the master storyteller, using creative ways to tell people the good news without getting killed for it, until he was killed for it. I was still in college when I first heard the British punk rock band The Clash. It completely changed my musical perspective. And through the years, I've mentioned their influence countless times in interviews and bios. But there was another Brit that had an equally profound influence on the way I write lyrics, and I haven't given him enough credit. He is the British author Oz Guinness, and around the same time, I heard him give a lecture on the art of subversive communication, where he showed over and over again how the prophets in the Bible used artful, subversive storytelling and communication to get the attention of people who didn't want to listen. Think of the prophet Nathan. King David has an affair with Bathsheba, then has her husband killed in order to cover it up. The prophet Nathan comes to him, tells him a story about a poor man whose pet lamb is stolen and eaten by a wealthy neighbor, and David is so outraged that he demands the death penalty for this thief. Then Nathan raises a bony finger, points it at his king, and says, "You are the man." We see it in the teachings of Jesus, when the religious leaders try to trap him by asking if it's right to pay taxes to Caesar. Jesus asked them to show him a coin. Whose image is that? Caesar's. Then give back to Caesar what is Caesar's, and to God what is God's. Artful, subversive storytelling. And we see that pattern used over and over again in the Bible, where a story or a metaphor lures people in, lowers their defenses, and then the truth bomb gets dropped. It's why I became a songwriter. Music lures in listeners, a good melody or beat lowers their defenses, and then you're able to drop a truth bomb that might not stick in the context of a speech or a sermon. Satire works the same way. Comedy is the lure, laughter lowers our defenses, and boom. But from the vantage point of 2020, we have to admit that American Christianity is mostly failing when it comes to using subversive art and storytelling to speak prophetic truth. We have this wildly subversive countercultural faith that stands in direct opposition to an American culture that's fixated on money, on power, on winning at all costs, on instant gratification. Hold on. Money, power, winning at all costs, instant gratification. Did I just describe our president? Boom. I just spoke a truth that a lot of my fellow Christians don't want to hear. It's not my best work. It was a little clumsy, but I did at least manage to lower your defenses for a minute. Now, I'm not here to get political, and what I just said is not political. It's the truth, even if it's a truth not everyone wants to hear. There is likely a wide spectrum of political leanings represented within the Hutchmood audience. And there's likely an equally wide spectrum when it comes to interpreting various political questions of the age through the lens of Scripture. But let's think about this. In John 18, Pilate famously asked the question, "What is truth?" in response to what Jesus has just told him. "The reason I was born and came into the world," says Jesus, "is to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of the truth listens to me." In John 8, Jesus tells us that when the devil lies, quote, "he speaks his native language, for he is a liar and the father of lies," end quote. Which I guess makes our current president his aspirational nephew, telling an average of 24 lies a day in 2020, according to Forbes, a habit that began decades before he ever entered the White House. Would that same Jesus tell his disciples to prop up a guy who's lied 20,000 times since taking office? Do we really think that the prophet Jeremiah or the prophet Isaiah or the prophet Amos or the prophet Jesus would be a shill for this president like so many of our evangelical leaders? I had my crisis of faith in college, and it was pretty intense. I didn't know if I could trust anything I'd been raised to believe. So I started doing my homework, and I came to the conclusion that Jesus didn't make any sense to me unless he was the actual resurrected Son of God. I do not have this all figured out. I've still got so many questions that I would love to have answered in this life, although I'm prepared to wait on some of them until the next. But I'm a Christian because I believe it is the truth. That when Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life," he was correct. I'm not a Christian because it makes me feel good. I'm a Christian because the world doesn't make any sense to me apart from the truth of Jesus. So what is going on right now? How has so much of American Christianity, the whole spectrum, from fundamentalism to progressivism, seemed to have given up on the pursuit of truth? Why is it only selectively applied to our enemies? Why was the progressive wing of Christianity mostly silent about personal morality until a certain reality star entered the White House? Why do so many Christian conservatives idolize an immoral despot, shrugging off his shameless behavior so they can sit at his table and get an illusory taste of power? When did we decide that winning was the greatest commandment? In the prophetic words of the writer Michael Gerson, "a faith that makes losing a sin will make cheating a sacrament." It's 2020. Too many of our Christian leaders have sold us out and are now trying to convince us that the ends justify the means. So what does faithfulness look like when our world is on fire? Who's going to tell the truth? You are. You are creative. Whatever career you pursue, use your God-given creativity to courageously tell the truth, because it is in short supply these days. When we tell the truth, we set people free. I'm not saying any of this is easy. I'm just saying it's our God-given job. Yes, it starts with talent, but talent has to be matched by a work ethic and a commitment to quality. You've got to be willing to put in the time that's required for excellence. And don't confuse success with quality. They are not the same. Van Gogh sold exactly one painting in his lifetime. The great film director Terrence Malick will never make a blockbuster movie. John Coltrane's A Love Supreme has yet to be certified platinum. And it took years for Leonard Cohen's Hallelujah to be hailed as the songwriting masterpiece it is. But the creativity and courage of artists like these inspires me, and hopefully inspires you, to work harder and get better at our craft. Know your Bible. Grow in your faith. 1 Corinthians 2:16 tells us how to develop the mind of Christ. Because as we learn how to think like Jesus, we realize we don't need to make Christian propaganda. The mind of Christ will flow naturally out of the work we do because it's the overflow of who we are. Here's the rule I try to live by. Given the choice between doing good work that's commercially risky versus artistically mediocre work that you think will sell, always choose to do good work. If you do mediocre work and it sells, well, at least you got paid, but you'll become cynical. If you do mediocre work and it doesn't sell, you're broke and you're a hack. Whereas if you do good work and it doesn't sell, it's still good work. And when good work sells, it inspires others to greatness. Remember that greatness usually springs from community. So many of our best artists came out of a community of artists, and it can spring up anywhere. I've seen it spring up right here in the Hutchmoot community. Good job. Use your community to inspire each other, collaborate with each other, encourage each other, hold each other accountable to great work. Finally, pursue it all with a winsome sense of humility that recognizes where your gifts come from. Years ago, I funded an album on my credit cards to keep a great band from breaking up. Sixpence None the Richer went on to achieve the kind of worldwide success nobody thought possible from an indie label. It took an insane amount of work from the band and all the staff at the label I founded to release that album and ultimately take their single to number one in 10 countries around the world. But this, for me, was the moment that made it all worthwhile.
Have a seat. I'm such a boob. I dragged you away prematurely.
Yes, I'm sorry.
Nice to meet you. How are you doing?
Very well.
Where are you from? Texas?
Texas.
Just took a guess there.
New
Austin?
Braunfels. You took a guess.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Austin?
New Braunfels. It's really close to Austin.
Where, New Braunfels. What? Spell that.
N-E-W.
Right.
Capital B-R-A-U-N-F-E-L-S.
What? So it's a, there is a...
How come every night we usually get a ding when something like that? There you go.
Tell me about the name of the band.
It comes from a book by C.S. Lewis in the book.
So I was close when I said it was Dickensian.
English.
Well, it could have been farther away.
Right. No, yeah, you are close.
So it's a literary, point, yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. Literary reference. The book is called Mere Christianity.
Yeah. And does in the passage, in what context do we find it?
Oh, thanks for asking. I will quickly tell you.
Take all the time you need.
Thank you. All right.
What's the matter? You all right?
This is awesome. This is just, all my dreams are being fulfilled. Let me tell a story, though. There's a...
I do want to hear it. That's very sweet of you to have said that.
Okay, well, thank you. All right, a boy asks his father for assistance.
Are you staying in town?
no, yes. Yes, we are.
Could I drop by the hotel? Sorry, I'm being needlessly coarse. I'm sorry.
I'm going to say this.
All right, so anyway, okay.
A little boy asks his father to, if he can give the if he can get a sixpence, which is a very small amount of English currency, for the boy to go and get a gift for his father. And then the father gladly accepts the gift, and he's really happy with it, but he also realizes that he's not any richer for the transaction because he gave his son the money in the first place.
He bought his own gift.
That's right, yeah. Pretty much. Mm-hmm. But I'm sure it meant a lot to him, but he realizes he's no richer.
Yeah.
C.S. Lewis was comparing that to his belief that God has given him and us the gifts that we possess, and to serve him the way we should do it humbly, with humble hearts, realizing how we got the gifts in the first place.
Well, that's beautiful.
Yeah.
That's very nice.
makes perfect sense. You know, it's, when you hear something explained that is so obvious, but yet we need to be reminded of it almost every minute of every day, but if people didn't need to be reminded of that, there'd be fewer boobs running around doing boob-like things, you know?
I agree.
If we could just keep that little sliver of enlightenment with us, things would be so much better.
I agree.
Well, nice to see you. God bless you.
Thank
you very much. Lee Nash, ladies and gentlemen.
I remember being in the audience with my wife, Debbie, when Letterman called Lee over, something he almost never did with his musical guests. And I remember thinking, this is not gonna go well. But Lee kept her poise by being her charming self. Letterman dropped his guard. She told the story winsomely, and that beautiful sound when a truth bomb gets dropped. None of this is easy, but as followers of Jesus, we have no choice. You are the light of the world, Jesus tells us, whether we want that responsibility or not. Let your light shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. Or as that beautifully written song from your childhood says so eloquently, shine.